Hey, you. Yeah, you. Do you plan on retiring at any point in your life? Like ever? Ever wondered how the logistics of that might work out? Like, if you retire, you're not going to be working a job. Assuming that you're like most people and have only one major source of income, a problem that we'll tackle on Not Learned later, that means that you won't be bringing in any new money. And if you don't bring any new money in, you'll be using what you already have until you die. So you better have a lot saved up by the time you get to that point. So how much? Well, that's a pretty good starting point for what I want to do first. First, I want to convince you that investing in the stock market is, for most people, not optional if you plan on retiring at any point. How much you end up needing for retirement depends on how much you anticipate spending during each year of retirement and how long you estimate being retired. The average American lifespan is about 80 if we round things off. So say you retire at around 62, which is roughly the average for Americans at this point. That means that the average person can expect to roughly 18 years, let's call it 20 for the sake of keeping round numbers, of retirement before they die. Now, let's say that you want to retire on $50,000 a year. So that's 50,000 times 20 years, coming out to a clean 1 million. That is not factoring in inflation during those 20 years, of course. That's one way to estimate. Thing is, there is going to be inflation during that time. That's going to devalue your money by usually around 2 to 3% every year, and you really do have to factor that in. Also, you got to expect that as you get older, your health will decline, especially if you're not in the habit of taking care of yourself, and those costs can become mountainous. So, a common rule of thumb that's used here is the 4% rule. Plan to have enough of a nest egg that your planned yearly expenditure is 4% of your total. So in this case, if we wanted to spend $50,000 a year, we'd want to build up about $1.25 million in investments. If you're retiring early, which we'll touch on in a minute, you may want to use more like a 3% rule if you anticipate being retired for longer, or build even more of a cushion in if you prefer to be overprepared for any curveballs life throws at you. So now we have a ballpark idea of how much we'll need. How do we get there? Let's go back to that idea just now. Inflation is going to devalue your money every year that you hold it. So if you're going to hold it, you need to find a way to do that in such a way that you get returns to offset the effect of inflation. Otherwise, you're actively losing money. The national average interest rate on a savings account in 2020 stands at around 0.06 APY, or annual percentage yield. But you can get rates as good as 1.5% in high yield savings account if you shop around and you qualify. The average long-term inflation rate has held between 2.3 and 3.2%. Even on the low end of that, the money you keep in your bank account is not returning enough to keep up with inflation, and over time its buying power will decrease accordingly. Moving on from bank accounts, consider the least risky place to store your money to money market accounts or money market funds, which can be thought of as the second riskiest place to store your money, have higher interest rates with often almost comparable security, but the best of these will give you only around 2% interest. So really, you're still losing money here. Now, we won't touch on financial products like certificate of deposits in this video, but you get my point. Most of these common ways to store or invest your money won't net you enough return to beat inflation. Stocks, however, are quite likely to help you beat inflation with some very basic know-how. The average annualized return for the S&P 500 for the past 90 years is 9.8%. Real estate investment, a generally more active enterprise, is also likely to help you beat inflation. In fact, there's actually a couple ways that you can beat inflation if you're keen on having a selection to choose from, not least of which is simply having a larger income shovel slash day job. Once we've established that there are certain avenues that we can use to beat inflation, we need to start thinking about how we can beat taxes. Because remember, all of this gets taxed. Uncle Sam always gets his cut. You don't get to just walk away with free money. Everything gets taxed. Then we start talking about accounts that we can hold these stocks in. Everything from 401k slash 403bs with employer match to health savings accounts to Roth IRAs. And hey, don't some of those sound familiar? You may have heard your parents or friends talking about them at some point. What even are these accounts? Well, they're just what I said. ways to stave off the tax man. When you get a real adult job, your employer is likely to start an account like a 401k, or if there's a nonprofit, a 403b, on your behalf. And you may have what's called a match, wherein your employer puts in as much money into your retirement account as you do, thereby matching your contribution. This is the only vehicle I can think of where people will give you free money, and it's totally not a scam. This is actually a situation where if you put in up to a certain amount in this account, you will automatically double that money, and it'll grow tax-free until you withdraw your money. Now, the catch is that you have to wait until you're at least 59 and a half years old, or they'll charge you 10% on anything you withdraw. The upside is that you can essentially double your money instantly. So naturally, one rule we got to establish when saving for retirement is that if you have an employer match on your retirement account, you should max that out. It's literally free money. Like actually, it really is. Then we hit things like the Roth IRA, which has a more forgiving withdrawal limit of 5 years from deposit and helps you avoid taxes at withdrawal. We also have health savings accounts, for which you can only use on medical expenses, which, as we said before, can be very high once you get older, and allow you to make tax-free deposits. Once again, these are different types of accounts with their own rules and regulations, which we'll cover in more detail in the blog. Suffice it to say that these two particular Roth IRA and HSAs are generally good ideas to have and to contribute to with your extra money. Extra money. I'll emphasize that a little bit more later. There'll be some not learned videos on financial products like these in the future, but for now you can learn a little bit more by hitting up my blog for a primer slash glossary that accompanies this video. Link in the description. But for this video, I'd like to focus on what these accounts fundamentally do. They allow you to invest in the stock market. That's what they're doing. The amount that you put in is not the total amount that you'll get out. How do you think these accounts are yielding all that money? They are investing your money in the stock market, and that extra yield is coming from stocks, whether that be in the form of dividend payments or capital gains. Retirement accounts will generally be highly diversified accounts that invest according to a pre-planned strategy. Now, note when I say diversified, I mean I'll generally try to invest in companies from different sectors of the economy to minimize the effect of market downturn.